Somerset, and Nicola
Peel,
who has several different hats. I'm going to let her introduce what they are. Basically, she is at the end of knowing what the solutions are and
it's a big
one. And executing them, operating them. I'm not quite sure. And I am somebody who's written about off-grid. I have a place that's off-grid, but I don't live in it full-time. I love to move around between being off-grid and on-grid in the world and outside the system. I like them both. But I feel that there isn't enough opportunity for people who want to be off-grid to try it out for themselves. And there's a tiny minority who've managed to do it, and there's a huge pent-up demand to live off-grid, at least some of the time, but you're not allowed to do it. And the problem is, how can we arrange things so you are allowed to do it? And there's, you know, all a vast number of forces lined up against it, and yet there seems to be this demand and interest and desire. And so I wish that an event like this that we're at, this big conference, could all come together and focus on that one thing, you know. And out of the talks that are all going on here, we'd be trying to get one successful off-grid community in this country. I mean, by successful, I mean of 300 houses or more, as opposed to a few here and a few there. It doesn't really add up to anything. And all of whom are treated as exceptions to the general rule, which is that you're not allowed to live off-grid. And I would love to see the fracking movement join in with that, because I think it's a positive statement of what they currently is a negative campaign, trying to stop something. But it is a campaign, it's a group of people who've come together, and I'd love to see a similar campaign around off-grid. So that's somehow the perspective I bring, or possibly the context that we're all here in. And now I'd love to ask you to talk about.
Yeah, so as Nick said, I live at Tinker's Bubble, which is a fossil fuel-free community about 40 miles away from here. Just arrived on the bikes, got absolutely drenched on the way. I've lived there for about 5 years, which have been absolutely fantastic. A lot of people ask me, what was it that made me decide to live there? Why have I gone off-grid? And I was asked partly to speak about that today. So at the time when I was thinking about leaving years ago, I was starting to see the collapse of our civilization happening. As this century unfolds, we're starting to see a huge oil crisis. We're starting to see the economies collapsing because of that oil crisis. We're starting to see climate change unfolding. At the time when I left, climate change looked like it was something that was perhaps in the distance, too far away to be worrying so much, and that it was peak oil. Now fracking slowed peak oil down, not by too much, and I think we're going to see the economy sliding and sliding over the next few years. And climate change is rearing its head and looking far worse than most people thought 6 or 7 years ago. And the reasons for going off grid, there's many compelling reasons, and some of them are to do with resilience and some of them are to do with sustainability. The resilience reasons: when you're off the grid, as everything else comes cascading down and fuels run out, or maybe the governments decide that we can't continue using all the coal, you've got that resilience there. You've got your access when there's blackouts, that you've still got your own electricity supply. When if the water starts running out, as we drain our aquifers, as these other crises unfold, you're there, you've got your own resilience. As the nitrates run out, as we can't fuel our truck, we've got their own built-in resilience that you can stand up. It might not be enough, but it's more than you'll have in the mainstream. And the other side is the sustainability side. That being off-grid, you're set limits. You set yourself limits. It's so easy when you're in the mainstream that you go there and you've shit into your drinking water. And it just seems perfectly natural. If you've got your own water supply, where you have to provide yourself with your own water, you don't waste your water in that way. And you do something sensible, like composting it. And you don't fritter away all your electricity. Because you fritter away your electricity on your computer, in the middle of December, and you've got no lights for a month. Whereas if you're on the mainstream, you can fritter it away as much as you like, and everyone's going to suffer at the same time. And people have that feeling, oh, well, it doesn't make any difference if I switch off my computer, because there's another 64 million people out there who are all going to leave their computers on, so why should I bother? And I think Nick talked about how he thinks we should have one big off-grid community. I think that'd be great if we can get it to work, but I still think there is a great power in having lots of small off-grid communities, and there's lots of communities already out there who need more people and who need support from people who are willing to work hard and who want to fight for the cause. I think there's plenty of opportunity, and we can set examples to the world. We need to be out there showing them a way forward, a future, giving them a hope and showing people change. It may seem that it's insurmountable, the challenge in front of us, but gradually we can start inspiring people, and as time goes by, the people who it may seem won't shift now will start feeling ashamed as they see people around them changing, and gradually we'll change the world.
So it's good to know that there are places that are looking for people, the off-grid communities are right now looking for people. Do you know any of those, Nicola? Are you looking for people?
No.
To join your off-grid communities?
I'm not. I mean, I live in my own little bubble, in my own little off-grid way, but I'm not part of a community here at all.
But you set up communities, don't you?
Not so much as set up communities. I work in communities around the world. I've set up cooperatives, which is one leg of one of the projects that I do. A bit of my background, I work mainly in South America, and I've been looking at basically how we can deal with rubbish off-grid. So in areas where there's no such thing as a rubbish man, what do you do with the rubbish? So I've been teaching how to build out of it. We've built schools, health centres, environment centres, restaurants, walls, benches, out of villages' rubbish. So that's one side that I have been working on, is working with EcoBricks and building, and here as well, building benches, building walls in community gardens, building compost systems. How do we actually become zero waste ourselves? So as long as we live in this world where we can still be off-grid and send all our rubbish away, and you know, there isn't an away. And the more we can close our own circle and our own cycle, then we can again become more resilient by building out of our waste. So that's one of the projects that I coordinate. I also work on bioremediation, using fungi, bacteria and plants to clean up contaminated land. And we're working with the biggest oil spills on Earth are in the Amazon, and most people don't know anything about it. So the huge oil spills in the Ecuadorian Amazon, I've been coordinating a team of scientists using bioremediation to work on cleaning up the land down there. So I also teach about rainwater systems, the importance of composting, compost toilets, and lots of other permaculture techniques, which just make communities more resilient within their own environment. People that are already living off-grid, but what we experience a lot in the Amazon is a toilet issue where they've always just gone anywhere. You just go out in the forest and you just go wherever, which, you know, it's not that much of a problem to some, to others it is. Whereas to speak to them about building a compost toilet is a bit, that sounds a bit too much. But to just dig a hole and get the whole family to shit in one hole and then stick a banana tree on top, that's doable. They can do that. So it's working, you know, taking step by step to, when we're living in an off-grid kind of society, how do we think of everybody? So it's all right if it's just you shitting out and you're not going to contaminate yourself. But when there's other people, that's when you start to get cross-contamination. So looking at, you know, the most practical, simple solutions has been very much what my focus has been around the place. So that's a little bit of my work, yeah. And also setting up cooperatives for people that are resisting the oil industry. So because they're not wanting to work in the oil industry, giving them other alternatives to them, for them to be able to find a source of income.
So Tinker's Bubble is what, about 30 homes? Is that right?
Not as much as that. There's 12 adults living there and 4 kids.
And what, in your opinion, what is the, Nicola, what is the sort of minimum size number of homes that you have to be a community to somehow have the skills and the kind of scale to be able to build the solutions you want to build?
Well, I think community can start with from one family. You know, within one family, you are your own community. So, and it can go, I don't think I could put a size or a limit on a community. I think that it starts from ourselves to our own family, through to however many. That, I mean, they say that there is a limit within a community to make it actually functioning before you want to start subdividing into smaller groups. So, what that limit is, I'm not sure.
Yeah, and certainly we found each time we go past 10 people, things start becoming harder to decide. It's harder to do consensus decision making, that there always seems to be two people who conflict. And before, everyone's got on really well with everyone, but somehow two people challenge each other. But yeah, as you said, even just with a family, you've got community, and each person you get beyond that family is an extra pair of hands to help. It's someone else to look after all the animals while I'm away here talking, and you know, someone else to share all the work.
And make sure the power station keeps running.
Yeah, it's a different set of skills. You know, one more person will come along and someone knows how to look after all the batteries, and someone else knows how to work the ram pump for the water.
Exactly.
There's in South America, all of the indigenous people, once a month they have something called a minga, and every group does this. And that means that the entire community will come together for one weekend, and there's no excuse. There's just everybody is a part of it. From children from 7 years old, the boys are taught how to use machetes, and on this one day, everybody does something. It could be cleaning the football pitch, and because they don't have any motorized stuff, so they're all out there with the machetes cleaning a whole football pitch. If a bridge is down, they'll all get together and fix the bridge. If someone's roof is off, they'll all come together and help fix someone's roof. So one day a month, the whole community benefits each other. And so this is something which they have always done, always will do, and the women make chicha, which is the traditional drink. And so they work all day. Women look after the tiny children. The men do physical labour, fixing things. And it works really well. And it's such a strengthening part of their community as well, all coming together to benefit the whole community. So it's an interesting way as well of looking at how community works. And I don't see enough of that happening in this society.
And how big, building a bridge, that's quite a big thing. How big a community are you talking about? How big an area?
A lot of the kind of community sizes down there, I would say, are around about, you've probably got 30 houses round about that, I would say, ish. That would be a rough guesstimate of within small communities.
It makes sense, doesn't it, that 30 would give you, 30 families would mean, you know, 10 different skills, maybe. Someone who can do the fire and the solar and the
There's none of that down
waste
there.
And the agriculture. Well, it's just beginning, isn't it?
Yeah.
The World Bank has got a program of.
Well, this is the madness. In Ecuador, the equator, they have the most sun than anybody, and you don't ever see a solar panel. And so last
you get kerosene, don't you? Which is bad for people's eyes.
Yeah. Last weekend, and I'd hardly recommend anyone that wants to do it. There's a guy, Simon, that's doing courses in London and Bristol on how to build your own solar panels. And so I did the course last weekend so that I would be able to find a way of teaching the people down there how to make their own solar. And there's so much waste from the solar industry, because he was saying that 99% of solar chips are coming over from China. So there's a huge amount of transportation, and in that, lots of them get damaged. So all of the chips that have a tiny little chip in them can't be used in the industry. So there's a massive amount of waste that's also coming from the solar industry. So for a fraction of the price, you can learn how to build your own solar panels and he's just using old double glazed windows and putting the solar cells inside that. So it's a really great technique for us to all be able to, and then you're not stuck with the standard oblong shape. You can also build solar panels to whatever shape you actually need them and want them for. But for me, it's so that I can take that information and start teaching people in South America how to build their own panels down there as well.
It's a great idea. And I suppose the same thing applies to building shelters as well. Are there any earth ships there at Tinker's Bubble?
We haven't gone for earth ships. I mean, one thing we've got is an abundance of wood, so we just work with the materials that we've got. We've got a steam engine powered sawmill that gets us lots of nice sawn timber and about 14 acres of conifers that need thinning, and as we thin them, there's bits and pieces of the trees that just make fantastic building material. You get nice poles at the top, which you can see some of them over on the Tin Village buildings out there, which make rafters for buildings, or you can make easily make timber frames.
And is that all part of your economy as a community?
Yeah, there's not much economy going on. We do work days to cut down trees that need to be done, and that's just communal work. And then if people want bits of trees for a project, then they can help themselves to it. There's a sawmill business, which is a business, which is one of our ways of trying to make money, partly because the council want us to make money and to show that we're earning a living, and partly because we still need to interact with the outside world. We're not completely self-sufficient. And so we have this weird economy that you're buying timber from the sawmill and then paying yourself to work on the saw bench and to drag logs out with the horse and to cut the tree down. That's the main economy of it. And generally people will help each other out, give us a hand to do it, or happy to borrow the volunteers that we have and get them to help you build your house.
Are there people here who live not off-grid but want to live off-grid or are thinking of trying to?
Yeah.
Quite a few, yeah. And listening to what we've just heard, would you rather live in a commune like Tinker's Bubble, or a community where they're kind of separate households and you're not tied to a group decision about how you earn money? Or any answers out there? Bit of both. Very difficult.
I'd just like to ask a question, which is, how do we? It kind of feels a bit incongruous to me that we're teaching Indigenous people in the Amazon how to be self-sufficient, and teaching them how to shit and how to build solar panels. I mean, these guys, have managed very well, actually, and shouldn't we be doing more learning than teaching, frankly?
Well, that's a great question, but I think that it's sharing knowledge. So, for instance, the soil down there is very poor, so they have trouble growing things. They don't know about composting. It's never been a part of their reality to compost. So do we not show them about composting? Do we not show them that if you shit in a hole and put a banana tree on it, you're going to get a much higher yield than if you don't? So I think that sharing knowledge with them is helping them increase their own food production, because we're used to living in a world where all the leaves fall off the trees and we get this nice healthy topsoil. But if you live in the Amazon, that doesn't. And what's happened, that they used to really depend on hunting and gathering. Well, that's been hunted and gathered out now. So because of the exploitation that has come in the Amazon and the roads that have gone through, there's not anywhere near the hunting that they used to be able to do. So what's happened with the destruction? I mean, huge, huge areas of deforestation. How can the people, they're not used to living, they're used to being able to hunt and gather, to go out to the forest and gather what they need, when their entire area has been taken away so that sugarcane and palm oil can be grown for us? They're not benefiting from it at all. So what's happened there now is their diet has become really bad. So they need to start growing more food. They need to start growing more food close to them.
Well, we need to stop
Absolutely. And people need to stop buying stuff which has got palm oil in it and got sugar in it and got lots of coffee and soya and sugar. And we all have all of that. So it's like we are responsible for that destruction. So I feel that we also need to be responsible in helping with solutions. So we can't go and cut it all down and then say, oh, well, now you get on with it. Because they can't and they're not.
But obviously we've also got plenty to learn from them.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's always a two-way. It's always a two-way, you know, when you're sharing with them, they're sharing with you.
The point is, if you, the more you interfere, the less you have to learn, because the indigenous culture is assuming our Western values, not Western ideas and so on. So actually, you know, whilst the logging is destructive, I'm concerned that our influence on civilization in such areas is as destructive.
So if we don't go in with the information, for instance, about compost toilets, what's happening now is that there's the big push that everyone needs to shit in water, because that's what civilization does. So now that's what they're believing, that's what they need to do. They need to get, you know, a flushing toilet. So is that better? Is that better to allow them to go down that road?
Well, is it what they want? Do they enjoy it, the ones who've got them?
It's whether it's what they want, it's whether they think what they think they should do. And the same as living in a house with a tin roof, that's what they think they should do. So now, I mean, when I started to work there 14 years ago, there was lots of thatched roofs, lots of wooden houses made out of the natural resources. Now it's more and more difficult to find natural built houses. They are all concrete breeze blocks with a tin roof, because that's what they feel like they need to be developing. They don't want to live in a wooden house because they think that makes them look poor. That's how the people feel about it. To live in a house with a tin roof and a concrete base is so hot and it's so noisy, they're unbearable. They are just horrible structures to live in. So but this idea of development makes them feel that's what they need to do.
It's not just them. I mean, I once was trying to persuade the General Secretary of the Labour Party to get interested in off-grid and include it in their environmental legislation. And she said, I grew up in a house that didn't have a toilet. I'd never want to live like that. And that was the end of the discussion. Labour Party never got involved. Question?
I do a lot of work in China. My subject is anaerobic digestion, so we make energy from waste. And they were the leaders. And one of the reasons why the Chinese were so prolific was that they collect up all their waste, they don't let it contaminate the water, and they make gas from it, and they cook from the gas. And
absolutely.
But that was a long time ago, and they completely forgot.
It's still there. It's still there. I met a professor who said that he'd been there just a couple of years ago. Mm. And it happened because Mao decreed it.
Yeah,
Mao said every village had to have one.
Yeah.
And they get methane gas from it for cooking.
But what I'm saying is it's
and
worth
lighting.
Not getting out there.
And it's still there because this prof went around sort of looking.
Mm.
And, you know, where there are villages, they still have. But anyway, that's a great example of a piece of third world so-called technology that we can use here now. Although, only if you've got a big enough community. A single family wouldn't quite fill it.
No, I do know of families in Ecuador that are single families that are cooking on their own methane.
Really?
Yeah. They have a system where they have got their pigs. So there's the pig shit and there's the human shit. And that is going down into a long plastic tube. It is the most simple, and it just going up with a pipe straight up to the kitchen and the women are cooking on it. So that is one family that is cooking off their own gas.
Amazing. Well,
but you need animals as well.
Yeah, I wonder what health and safety would have to say when the neighbours, you know, snooped on you. Sorry? They won't notice. A few pigs. Yeah, well. I don't know. As I said, I'm making a film a few miles away from here about some people who want to try and live off-grid. But, you know, and they're trying to do it legally. They're teachers and architects, and they've bought a piece of land and they're cultivating it. And the neighbours know everything that's going on there, even though it's just on the edge of the village. Every vehicle movement is noted. But, you know, and the planning battle will, I hope that they'll kind of reach an agreement. And, you know, it's about talking to the community and not kind of seeing yourself as different. Tinker's Bubble had a trouble for a long time getting accepted by the community, I think, didn't it?
Yeah, it took quite a few years. I mean, well before my time, you know, when I moved there 5 years ago, the community had been going for 15 years and was accepted by most of the community. We did meet someone the other day who said, I objected to you, you know. I was like, you're not going to now, are you? Yeah, I still object. Why? Don't like what you're doing.
Why are you allowed to do it when I can't do it in my field? That's one of the most common complaints. Yeah.
In terms of, like, I mean, a small group of people going off and setting up something like Tinker's Bubble is, you know, that's not going to address, you know, the fact, you know, I live in Bristol and there's, you know, 470,000 people who live there. And so my question is, how do you take off grid, you know, we're looking at, what, how many is 9 billion people by 2050? You know, it feels like a bit like, you know, unless we're going to have a lot less people, then how are you going to manage energy sort of supplies for the scale of 500,000 people, for example, like in Bristol? You know, particularly with the land issues, you know, the land ownership issues in the UK make it very difficult for anyone to even disperse people around because they can't, you know. And then you also have the huge resource issue. It's all right saying let's have a, you know, if you all get solar panels, but solar panels don't come from nowhere. You know, they all peak. You know, they all need these minerals and components and stuff to produce. And they're also actually produced by people who are being quite exploited, usually, in other parts of the world. So it's like, as much as I like to see a whole off-grid world, I don't really see how that move, you know, to take a city like Bristol and make it off-grid, or by retrofitting or whatever, how that can happen globally. That's my question, you know, because it has to be all of us.
Have you got an answer to that?
Not exactly, but yeah, that's the question I was going to ask. I was wondering if there are definite benefits to having a grid in terms of energy demand. People have different needs at different times, and district heating, for example, is more efficient than everyone having their own boiler because you've got one source and it's supplying many people.
Nobody's arguing against microgrids. That's what we all believe in, I assume.
And we make the grid more sustainable, not just renewable sources of energy and things, but is there a way we can improve what we've got, especially for mainstream living?
I mean, my answer to the question is, we can't solve the whole thing by everyone going off grid. We haven't got time to do that. I think as many people as can should go ahead and do that. We need to try and start sorting out the whole agriculture problem. We need to sort out this problem of massive farming and get out and start working on the land. But in the meantime, there's nothing to stop people living in their normal lives, their so-called normal lives, and just reducing their consumption massively. I've looked at the numbers, and I'll be doing a talk about this exact topic on Sunday called The Simple Revolution. And I believe that the average UK citizen can get down from 15 tonnes of CO2 to 2 tonnes without a massively drastic change to their lifestyle per year. And most of that is just doing stuff like not flying and not driving, which if you're in the city, it's quite easy to not drive, it's quite easy to not fly, and then start buying organic food as local as possible, getting a box scheme from nearest group. I mean, Bristol, that's, you know, perfectly easy to do, and reducing your meat. There's lots of things that you can do to reduce your impact and just have a lot less electricity. You can go off grid in the city in terms of electric, You can get your own panels and a backup system of batteries. There's some people, not many, who will do it so that if the main system cuts off, your batteries kick in. You could have load balancing. Apparently there's one company you can get it with.
Who's that? What, to say that
you can have a battery backup system in your house with the solar panels, yeah.
And it won't be turned off if there's a power cut in your area. That's
the
problem.
The
problem is that if you set yourself up to be off-grid ready with enough energy in your own home to supply your own needs but connected to the grid and using the grid as your battery, if there's a power cut, it's automatically switched off because that's the regulations. And although you said it's true that people, if they want to, should be go off-grid, they can't. They're not allowed to. You can't buy land and live off-grid. You can't take yourself off-grid ready in the city because of this rule that you're not allowed to connect to the grid and then sustain yourself in the event of a power cut. And so I come back to my original point, which was I wish we could all get together and try and together get the energy and the authority and the power and the money and the skills to create one much larger off-grid experiment and get people, maybe Thorston Park. I'm looking forward to meeting the guy who runs or owns this place, because this would be a perfect place for it, and find some land. And any lawyers in the room, or how about planning officers? Any other skills?
Can I comment on the cities? I really think for city living, to start with, is to get people to sign over to the Good Energy Company or Ecotricity. You know, as an initial step, that, and the Good Energy Company is saying that it doesn't cost any more to be with them than it does with the other big six. So for us, we're not being personally off-grid, but by the more people that, if we're against fracking, we're against, you know, extreme resources, what can we do? Well, if we haven't got the money to be able to buy our own off-grid setup, what we can do is start supporting solar and wind and that which is, you know, renewable energy. So if the people in the cities were changing their energy company, that would be a massive demand in renewables. Also, obviously, using roof space a lot more. The vision of the future of having a lot more food grown in the cities, a lot more vertical growing going on in cities, and really getting sensible with the use of cities. Instead of having lots of ornamental trees planted everywhere, you know, we really need to be getting into like food production trees in cities. And so also, you know, we can say no fracking, but then go home and turn on our gas cooker. It's like we've got to start being the change that we want to see. You know, rocket stoves are fantastic. If you don't have a rocket stove, get a rocket stove. And you can start cooking a little bit more on those. So even in, you know, cities, we can start to use more off-grid technology, whether that be, you know, having that demand on renewables, using, I mean, pallets are available throughout cities. Plenty of pallet wood and rocket stoves, you hardly use anything. Getting people to start coming together and sharing these technologies as well. I'm hoping he's going to come, but there's this mad genius called Ed Revel, and he has come up with this brilliant design which takes rocket stoves to the next level. So it's a simple rocket stove which at the same time makes biochar, which also heats water, which also you can cook on and you can also bake on from just using a few twigs. So starting to use these technologies all joined together, I mean, this is joined up thinking. And so the more we can start to use those wherever we are, it's not important whether we're in the country or we're in the city. These are the kinds of technologies that we can start doing, you know, making sure that there are as much water collection. I mean, you don't see that many rainwater butts in a city. There's not really any reason that we can't have. And guerrilla gardening, fantastic. And the more we can start getting more, you know, food grown in cities, that's what we've really got to start pushing for, is seeing a city greening, seeing the roofs being used for good purpose, seeing vertical land being used, and starting on bringing that, and starting coming into this idea like I spoke of earlier about the Minga, getting communities to come together and to say, okay, you know, let's do one day a month, one day every 3 months, to benefit our community. You know, what can we do in this local area? Can we plant something? Can we make a small pond? Can we get together and have one day of not cooking on gas, but we cook, you know, communal meal on a rocket stove? And I think that that change of consciousness is what is needed. It's not just about, oh, let's all run from the city and run for the hills, because that is, you know, a whole other subject in itself. But we've got to, you know, be realists, and that's one of, you know, my things. I am a total realist. In
so how do you think this community, you know, here we are at the Off-Grid Festival, where obviously there's a level of commitment to off-grid.
But there is and there isn't, because we've still
got... How do you think this community should or could come together and do a Minga? What would it be?
Well, I'd like to see an industrial-sized rocket stove built so that the cafes not aren't all cooking on gas.
Exactly.
So that's what we need to see. That's exactly what we need to see. Because up until now, that we're having, you know, renewable off-grid festivals, but we have always been cooking on gas. So these are the moves that we need to move towards as a community to say, well, okay, if we want to be the change and we don't want fracking, how do we go about actually not using the gas?
Okay, although it's not a game, is it? I mean, if we have to use a bit of gas, that doesn't mean that we're out.
No, but I think that
it's
we are
so,
moving
you know,
towards...
You've got to be reasonable and realistic about what's possible and practical and accept you can never be totally off-grid with your cell phone, but, you know, you can choose which bits of it to accept.
So do
There's
you
a
use
question
gas
over
at
there.
No, I mean, that, my sort of response to that is we've got an impact, and I calculated mine at about 1 ton per year, which is from the food we buy. And I think there's areas where it's really, really difficult to avoid. I mean, I think we probably could avoid some of that, but it's not a question of pick and choose. It's a matter of which ones can I manage to do without making my life miserable. I don't think we've got a choice of, all right, yeah, I do a little bit of recycling and I've taken the rocket stove. It's got to be, right, I'm not going to do any of these things, and I need to eat, and I need to go out and cut to the pub occasionally to keep happy and do that, but not do beyond what you absolutely feel you have to do.
Question over there?
Yeah, my sort of question was really about looking at sort of history of the national grid as the electricity grid. You know, sort of back about 1900, everybody was sort of what we would call off-grid. They had some small generation schemes, and they sort of clubbed together to make their use of power more efficient and share what they didn't, what they weren't using, that kind of thing. So my sort of question is sort of where and how did the grid go bad, as it were? Because we're sort of going back to almost where we were 100 years ago and trying to sort of reinvent it. And is that the best way of doing it? If everybody wanted to go off grid and bought batteries, you know, the first thing I would do is go and buy shares in lead mines. Obviously, it would just be silly. It would just be an environmental disaster, because the use of resources would be so inefficient. So it seems that the grid, as we know it, has somehow just gone. It's gone sort of pear-shaped.
I think
it sort of take that back.
My opinion is it went from supplying electricity to encouraging people to consume it, and its reason for being became getting us to use more and more energy. Does anybody remember the electricity showrooms and gas showrooms, which the electricity board sold you cookers from? And their job was to sell you things that would encourage you to use energy. And that was at the dawn of what is now called the consumer society. What about you? What do you think
was
the solution to that?
I mean, I think it went wrong around the Industrial Revolution. You know, at the point where we started burning lots of fossil fuels, which destroy the planet.
Okay, so
you know, maybe
well, 1940 from me, 1840 from you. What do you
I think just recently with the cloud, this idea that we've all got to have the latest gadgets. You know, it was only, what, a few years ago we had a little Nokia phone, charge it once a week and it did the job. Now everyone's got to have an iPhone which needs charging every night. Not only do we have an iPhone, we've got to have an iPad, and we've got to have an everything else. And so we're creating, it calls us as we speak about it. So, you know, it's this idea that we need to have more gadgets and more stuff to be in this world. There's no sharing. You know, what about having sharing a computer, sharing a washing machine, sharing stuff? Yeah.
There's a this gadget's only using 0.1% of the energy we use for heating water in homes.
And
but
construction.
The construction side of them as well, the rare earth minerals that is used in those, the inbuilt obsolescence, they're designed to break so that you buy another one. There's all of that, not just the amount that the powering of it on a regular basis does. There's the whole bigger picture of where it comes from, how it got to you, how long it's going to last before you buy a new one. So they're not designed to last, and they're designed to use power.
Can I ask something about cooking you were talking about earlier? I think everything's been brilliant and we need to do these things in cities. I'm wondering about the cooking on renewable fuels. And I've been experimenting with cooking my own tea and food on my little rocket stove and my little bush buddy burner, it's called, in central London.
Right.
And yeah, I mean, it works with some measure of success. But I wonder if everyone did it, I mean, there'd be laws about the smoke, and didn't they have laws about people heating their homes with wood fire, and what would happen if 8 million people in London all went back to burning wood in their own homes?
Wouldn't it be nice if people came into community and instead of one person, each one person sitting over their rocket stove cooking their meal, where a few people came together and cooked together? It's like that's the idea that we're moving away from, is this, it's all about me. We're living very much in a divided world right now. And I think part of, for me, part of the off-grid reality is the coming together.
Well, hang on, we have places where people go in communities to share a cooker. It's called a restaurant.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, we're talking about something different here, which is not about... I mean, Richard Hoggart, in The Uses of Literacy, said that in his... in a working-class street in the 30s, in 1930s in Britain, everybody would share a dictionary. They'd have one dictionary and one encyclopedia. And yeah, what we do now have is the internet, which has, I mean, in a way, I think being off the grid and on the cloud is one of the things I most like about being off grid. That I can be off some grids, but not others. And any other questions? Sorry.
I want to say, I think actually the grid itself is a good thing. The bad thing about the grid is the great big enormous power station. If you can use it as a balancing thing and you can put lots of renewable energy and just use the wires, that's a very, very efficient way of doing things. There is so much energy in the world.
Yeah.
It all comes from the sun. So it comes from waste food rotting and making gas, or whatever. Every single bit of energy we have comes from the sun. There's plenty of energy around it. It just needs to be balanced. And that's what you need the grid for, to balance it out.
That's why I think that the most important thing, if there was one thing I'd say, is change your energy company. If there's one thing that you can do, change your energy company so that you're demanding more renewables, so that people like Ecotricity and Good Energy, who are investing in a lot of, you know, that's what they're investing in anaerobic digestion in the future, in more solar, in more wind. I mean, that's what we've got to start investing in. So.
And I would say about that, that perhaps... in the long-term future, that could happen. But to avoid catastrophic climate change, we don't have time to switch over to renewables at the current consumption rate. We need to just massively reduce our consumption. At the moment, renewables are about 2% or something of our entire consumption. We need to get down our consumption to that level.
But is there anybody here who's imminently thinking of moving off-grid, who's currently living a wholly on-grid life and is right just about to do it now? Yes?
In the next year or two, maybe.
In the next year or two, I mean, like, okay. How about in the next few months?
Yeah. In transition.
So what's the move going to consist of for you? Are you already using tiny amounts of energy, or are you living in a van? Or?
I live in an old farm. In South Somerset, where it floods, I'm on good energy because I rent. I can't put solar panels on it. I have an energy monitor, so I religiously look at that daily and shout anyone who comes around with these light or anything on. So I'm.
So you're kind of training yourself.
I come from an environmental background, so again, I want to try as best I can in the environment I live to be the change I want to see. And my next step is to be off grid. because, you know, I try and educate and inspire other people to do that, but how can I do that unless I do it myself? And therefore, I'm going to start getting a static caravan off grids. I'm going to find ways to cook and heat things, not using fossil fuels, and supporting my boyfriend's mother, who already lives off grid in a straw in our house, and helping her, you know, make that change even better for herself while sharing things in our little family community. Yeah, and just waiting for planning to come through any day now, which is obviously a big hurdle to get through.
Well, good luck, because that's the big obstacle. Well, I don't know if we're getting any more questions. Yeah?
How many off-grid communities are there in the UK? Well, I think there are about six.
Truly off-grid, I'd say maybe 30 in the whole of the UK. What would you say?
It's really hard to say, because I know of some well-known mainstream ones. I know of a couple of secret ones, but if I know of a couple of secret ones, one of them's not far from me. How many more are out there? I don't know. There could be a couple of hundred out there. It might only be 30, I don't know.
We need more.
How do you see going off grid as a viable solution for people who are possibly living in London and don't have maybe the opportunity to build their own or the education to do something like going off grid?
Well, for me personally, if the question is, if you're living in a city, how do you go off grid?
Well, how do you see all of London going off grid?
Well, for me, I think there's a step in between, which is, I live in London, it's not off-grid, so I like to be off-grid part-time. I just love stepping between the two worlds. So I'm off-grid some of the time in a van or in my friend's land or whatever it might be, you know, all achievable by anybody else. And then I like to step back into the grid and, you know, live in both worlds. But ultimately, my forecast for 50 years' time is that all power will be local in microgrids, which then connect to the next door microgrids. But the national and international grids don't really exist anymore. They've been replaced. Electricity is being replaced by information. And what you're going to get is all the huge power stations will be in the desert somewhere where it's solar or, you know, nuclear. And all the server farms will be next to the power stations. And everything else will be local energy, especially food production. And, you know, all our, as somebody said, all our devices take a tiny amount of power to power them. They took a lot of energy to make them. That's how I see it.
Also where they come from. So if we look at the data centres behind Facebook, they don't take a little bit of power.
No, they're the ones that are going to have to be next to the nuclear power station.
Yeah,
but they probably have their own.
Basic needs, though. I'm not talking about Facebook or gadgets. I'm talking about cooking and water.
Yeah, and I mean, as I said,
produced by locally produced energy, methane, by recycling, by increased energy efficiency.
Methane from compost.
From compost, including human waste. Yeah, which at the moment is all completely wasted in cities where it's incredibly efficient. Of course, that's the most efficient thing you could do in a city for energy consumption. Question.
Sorry, can I answer her question?
Yeah, sure.
First? Because, I mean, as I said earlier, I don't think there's time for everyone to go off-grid that quickly. And there's lots of things we can do to just reduce our consumption. But on the other hand, in somewhere like London, there's loads of opportunities to learn. There's all sorts of city farms and other projects, people growing their own food and doing all sorts of stuff and lots of skill-sharing stuff. And the other one...
Trying to keep your children fed, or
well, perhaps not. I mean,
more disadvantaged communities that just don't even know that this is happening.
But yeah, I mean, it's perhaps difficult for, you know, someone like that. There are things like woofing, worldwide opportunities on organic farms, so you can go around volunteering on farms and take your children with you, or something like that. Obviously, lots of people aren't going to be aware of that sort of thing. But yeah, there are opportunities out there to learn how to live off-grid and how to manage. That's the best I can...
I think, again, is coming back to in cities is, you know, really starting to get, you know, small areas together in smaller communities where you can start, so even if it's guerrilla gardening, that coming together, growing a bit of food, showing how to use your own waste, which is what I'll be doing a talk on Sunday as well, is how to use your own rubbish by building things, whether you're building beds or you're building a compost system or you're building walls, but showing how that rather than, I mean, also so much energy is taken with us throwing our stuff away, with it just being shipped around the place in big recycling trucks and going off to the recycling centre where they use vast amounts of power to turn into something else. Actually, if we don't throw anything away and we use it ourselves, in your house, all it needs is just, instead of throwing things in a bin, keep an empty plastic bottle on the side. And all your packaging, anyone can do this. Instead of throwing it away, just put the packaging in the bottle. Jam it in with a stick and you make a brick. And
I get
with
through
that,
about 50 wine bottles a month. What should I do with
them? Plastic bottles. Well, same. With glass bottles, you can build. I mean, at the Earthship in Stanmer Park, they've got beautiful walls. And they don't need to be made for houses. But what I'm talking about is the plastic landfill, which is the issue. So, and recycling. Recycling, for me, also is a little bit of a cop-out, to be honest. Because it just perpetuates consumerism. Because people think, oh, well, I can drink as much soya milk as I want, because as long as I, and hummus, and as long as I put it in the recycling container, then I can keep on buying more and more stuff. It's actually questioning the roots of our consumerism, of saying, actually, how can we just reduce buying more stuff, making more rubbish, all of the power, the inbuilt power that goes into everything that we buy. That's where cities come in, when we see the huge amount of demand that comes out of a city. How can we start educating people to just use less of everything, and then what is made from waste, turn it into something useful, you know, turn rubbish into a resource. And so it is, we can't just flick the switch and turn to renewables. There has to be a major power down first, and keeping this vision like of anaerobic digestion and the issue with waste. So a good example is Brighton. I live quite close to Brighton. For 8 years, I've driven on reused biodiesel. And the guy I get it from in Chichester, he gets it from all the chip shops and the Indians and the pubs. Of course, not everyone can drive on it. There's not enough. But Brighton, a big city, has loads of restaurants, and there's not one biodiesel filling station. Same in London. You know, there's not enough. There's a lot of waste being made, but it's not being put into anything useful. And when I questioned the guy, where's it all going? He said it's all being shipped off to Italy and Switzerland, because Italy and Switzerland want to reduce their carbon emissions. Well, why don't we? Why doesn't every town actually collect its waste oil and drive some vehicles on it, collect all the food waste and have anaerobic digestion running on it, you know, have the vision of the future with composting toilets that's collected in some cities. I know Bristol does collect food waste.
So what do you recommend people actually do with their waste in a family or a small local community? What will you be showing us on Sunday?
Well, how we can... I mean, I've become zero waste myself. So
sure.
I can give my example. Okay, so we compost everything that can be composted, and then we recycle the little bit that can be recycled, and then the rest of it, we shove it in a bottle and we build something useful with
like
it.
Like what?
And then we've... Well, so far, I mean, here, I'm building a compost system, a little wall. I've also built schools, health centres, environment centres,
restaurants.
Sure,
but if you're a family with a house, you know,
yeah,
with maybe a small yard,
yeah,
what
you
can you
build,
do? What can
you
make with your place?
Ideally, people start going to community gardens together. That's the vision I like to see, is people coming together, having little social interactions, coming into community gardens. And in community gardens, there's usually places where you want to build little retaining walls, where you want to build a compost system, where you want to build a bed. And it takes an awful lot of rubbish to fill one bottle. And that's the thing, that's what you can start building something out of it. There's loads to build, and it takes a really long time. It's to actually build something, you need a community filling, using their waste.
Slave labour.
So yeah, basically, your own slavery.
I was going to say, with regard to biodiesel, I understand that a lot of manufacturers work on the
problems here on the engine. Happened to me.
Problem with biodiesel is that cars break down.
That's why before 2004, vehicles before 2004 is generally okay. There's also a website called biodieselfillingstations.co.uk. It tells you the cars, it tells you where they all are in the country, and what you want to look for. There's biodiesel and there's biodiesel. Biodiesel that is made out of waste oil is one thing. Biodiesel that is made out of vegetable oil is probably worse than diesel. In the overall impact of getting the vegetable oil to burn, bad idea. Unless it's 100% waste oil, don't touch it.
Better cycle. Any other questions? Have you asked one yet? Sorry, please go ahead.
Just wondering if you had any thoughts on kind of the best ways. We like talked about disadvantaged families and people who aren't aware of the imminence of us having to make these changes. You know, I live in a city, I live in Exeter, which is a fairly small city as cities go, but it's just saturated with consumerism, and, you know, the council's intent on more shopping centres, and, you know, there's like a whole other side to this that we haven't really talked about, which is this problem of capitalism and consumption. You know, how are you going to get cities, like restaurants and businesses, to care about this when actually, like, it's not necessarily going to make them more money? And it's all well and good saying, well, we can change to eco products and renewable energy, but actually we kind of touched on this, but, you know, to make a solar panel you need to mine. You know, if you've seen the pictures of the mines where solar panel materials come from, it's as bad as the tar sands. You know, like, realistically, technology, there's this illusion that technology is going to save us from the fact that there's too many people, and you know, this kind of message and myth that's been perpetuated that we can carry on the way the trend is going, but just geez, to make it all more efficient. Like, I mean, how do we kind of campaign to government or business, or like, what? How does that message kind of?
I think in every possible way that we can, we've just got to do everything to educate everyone. We've got to break that delusion. We've got to show people, I mean, exactly what you said. That's what I campaign for. I haven't found out how yet. I'm trying. I've gone for a website. I come to festivals and talk to people and try and show people that that's the case. And, you know, again, in my talk on Sunday, that's what I'm talking about, and how we need to reduce it. I think there is some hope in it, that we can actually make a difference, and that each individual can make a huge difference just by, you know, writing to every newspaper, write to your politicians. I don't have a huge amount of faith in that, but I'm going to do it anyway. I'm going to try and just show my politician that I care and that this is what I want. And we need to shut down all the greenwash and the bright siding that a lot of the environmental movement is saying, oh yeah, yeah, technology is going to fix it, and oh, we can't depress people about how utterly dire the situation is because they were all shut down. We need to stop all that nonsense and just get on and be straight with everyone at how serious it is. And as I said, just every possible route, attack it. I was starting to say about how we can make a difference. And I found that in my life recently, since I moved to Tinker's Bubble, that the number of people that I've affected and that I've managed to influence has amazed me. That sort of, you know, suddenly find that my parents are going, my son's living in this like strange off-grid way, and tell all their friends and family. They're sort of, you know, dismissive of it to me, but then they're taking those pictures and going around to all their friends and going, look what my son's doing, and look, he's working in this sawmill, and you know, and other friends and stuff, and you get volunteers come along, and you know, the word spreads around, and you can, one person can actually influence thousands of people, hundreds of thousands of people. You could write a book, and you know, people might read that and go, oh yeah, that's a good idea. I'll go and try to check out some of these places he's talked about in his book.
Boring, and if it sounds too like angst, people are not into it. Getting people to come together in however can be made, you know, wherever you live, into a fun activity day, which would draw people that wouldn't normally come, and that they're also getting the drip bit more information that they wouldn't get from their other sources. So, you know, for me, there's that having the fun activity days to educate people. I totally agree with writing to politicians, writing to papers. Every little part has its place to roll. And also not supporting the corporations. It's like we can live off-grid in our nice little world and then keep buying everything from Tesco's. And for me, that doesn't work at all. It's that we've got to, who is it that's contributing to the world that we live in? Who is it that's causing like the large-scale destruction, the large-scale mining? It's, you know, for me, there's that is a really big way of being the change that we want to see. It's that, yes, we want to support local businesses. If we keep supporting these massive businesses which are causing large-scale destruction, we're never going to move out. So, you know, understanding, you know, who people are, you know, the biggest power we do have is that pound in our pocket and who we give it to. That is what directs the world. We live in a world of supply and demand, cause and effect. And so starting to teach people about that as well, for me, is, you know, another driving force.
You mentioned the corporations and who are they. The corporations are almost an uncontrollable, autonomous system, and the people that are running them, if they was to change their attitude, someone else would step into their place and carry on. It almost needs laws or something to say stop, this needs to change.
Only because you buy from them. I don't buy from those corporations, and if everyone else stops
buying,
you're
in a tiny minority of people who live completely off grid.
No, I don't
all
either.
Self-sufficient. Most of
you
us
don't
do.
Either.
The people that work for them, you know, that are managing them, that are flawed. It is the, as Rob said, the capitalist mindset that is flawed.
Yeah.
And that's definitely across the board. I personally can't stand advertising. I think there's a better way of doing it. Word of mouth, obviously, is the way to do it. If products are good, then they don't need to advertise.
And that's where small is beautiful comes back in. When we keep remembering that saying and the importance of small is beautiful and support that, That is what's off-grid. Off-grid
absolutely
also,
right,
for me, is that idea of supporting the good guys, supporting the local farmers and the small businesses, and stop comparing the price. That's how we always fall down. And I know myself, and this is what helped me a lot. To start with, it's like the supermarkets, buy one, get one free, everything's cheap, 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 and that's what we think, cheap is good. And because we compare that to the local farmer who costs more, people keep going back down the cheap line. And it's like, if we just pretended they didn't exist, if the supermarkets just weren't there and our choice was to support the local farmer, we would pay a fair price. And that's what it comes down to, it's paying what's fair. And the other point, which is really important, is the legal side. Anyone that doesn't know about the law of ecocide, look into this as well. Polly Higgins, amazing lawyer, and she is working on bringing in this overriding law of ecocide. So, which is a crime against humanity. So if you haven't heard on ecocide, make sure you look it up, and that's a whole other really important part of the picture as well.
And then the other thing that, of course, we're all here to focus on this weekend is the positive step of living off-grid, either part-time or full-time, removing yourself from the grid, from removing your support. And JP Morgan, the bank, recently has found out that people going off-grid and giving themselves solar panels, producing their own energy, is in the process of destroying the energy industry as we know it. It's been all over the financial press already, but those of us who put a solar panel on our roof are helping change the system, because the old business model is now being declared defunct by the financial industry and will soon be gone. But on that level of doing something, I still believe that although it isn't true for everybody and 100% of us will never live off-grid, right now I still see the most positive single thing that anybody could do if they believe in these things we've talked about is to get together with some friends, find a place, move into a van, move to a field, do it yourself. That is the, you know, living the small is beautiful philosophy. One last question, and then we should probably stop. I don't know. We can keep on going if everybody wants to.
I'm I just wanted to respond to quite a few things. I agree that there is an issue with consumption, and you have some power with consumer, you know, what you buy and whatever. Most people don't have the resource to live off-grid or the ability to get there, though some do, but not many. The biggest power that we have is if we have actual control of the means of production within society. It's not about consumption. We can stop buying things. You know, is it going to change the power structure? The power structure exists because of the class system that we live in. And they have huge amounts of power, the people at the top. If you just look at the Tory government at the moment and the way that they're privatising the NHS and all the social services, you know, they are selling off everything to their mates. And so it's like the real power that we have is coming together as a mass movement and demanding that the government listens and does things which benefit our communities, you know, not feathering their own nests, which is what they're doing at the moment. The reason that we haven't got a decent energy supply in this country is because they privatised everything during the 80s. You know, EDF is a French company. You know, British Gas is no longer, you know, it's all our utilities were sold off, you know, for nothing. You know, they're on about selling the only rail service that actually made £1 billion worth of profit last year. They're in the process of privatising. So, like, there is a huge issue around power relations within society in order to do these things that we're talking about. And this is why lots of this stuff doesn't happen, is because it's not in the benefit of the, it's not for the benefit of the ruling classes for it to happen. You know, we know that most of these things would be of much more benefit to us. You know, all this stuff, I agree with everything you're saying. I mean, I work for Transition Network, you know, which is helping transition groups get up and running. But, you know, one of the main things, you know, the main barriers are, like you say, legislation, which is who sets the legislation. You know, the people in power. Who are the people in power? The millionaires. They're all millionaires. Look at the cabinet, they're millionaires.
But how are they millionaires a lot of the time? From people giving them money, somewhere, the drip feed, somewhere. They
have no option of, most people don't have the option of going and buying all their food from organic food farms because they can't afford to.
But
the reason people buy food from Aldi is because wages have been driven down since the 70s. You know, we haven't seen no real wage increases, real term increases. So people are strapped less and less. They have less and less money, and they are also sold. You know, you should have all these things as well. So people make choices. They make rational choices. I can go to Aldi and I can buy all my, I can do my week shopping. You know, you see the adverts. Buy this here, buy our own brands, or buy here. You know, this is for £30, this is £15. You know, and then you think, well, if I do that, that means I can do something else. You know, people aren't stupid. You know, it's not like, you know, they're short-term ways of living and engaging in society are very often dictated by. And I agree very much with the woman who was sat there earlier saying, like, you know, how do you sell this thing? And it's very difficult when most people don't have that economic choice. You know, a basic income in this country would make it a lot easier, for example. Everyone was given £12,000 a year to live, for example. That would make life a lot easier.
You could live on £5,000 a year if you were off-grid, but unfortunately you can't get off-grid.
And this is the problem.
I think, you know, whilst the system is flawed and, you know, there are all sorts of problems with it, lots of people who are on the very low income, apparently I'm in extreme poverty, okay, I live off grid, but a lot of people who are very poor have all sorts of gadgets. They have been sold the need to buy all sorts of crap that they don't need.
Most of it's bought in debt.
Some of it is, but I mean, actual spending has gone from, in the 1940s, we used to spend 25% of our income on food. Now we spend less than 10% of our income on food. Food prices have come down and down and down over the years. And it's not that organic food is expensive. It's that chemical food is incredibly cheap. And people make that choice and say, oh, well, I'll buy the cheap chemical food and I'll have a new iPhone and all these choices. And yeah, it is difficult, and the government don't help. But we can do a lot of this stuff despite them.
Oh yeah, for sure. I'm not saying don't do that. But I'm saying you should always bear in mind that there is a huge power structure within this country. You know, I mean, the middle classes are being decimated through, you know, austerity. You know, Bristol City Council has seen their budget slashed by 25% over 4 years. That is going to have a huge impact on people's well-being in Bristol. You know, they don't talk about it, but they're cutting, like, left, right and centre. I walk around Bristol and I see the impacts of mental health services being cut. You know, you can see it visibly. You know, so there are, you know, there's decisions being made which we don't have a choice, we don't have power over. You know, this austerity, which is a complete and utter bollocks, has been enforced on us. It's capitalism taking an opportunity, using, I recommend anyone read The Shock Doctrine by Naomi Klein about how they take these economic crises as an opportunity to drive through privatisation and dismantle public sector services.
Can we move on? Next question.
No, so I just want to respond to this. He's obviously very passionate about politics. Why don't you stand and be a Green Party politician?
Well, I'm involved in Left Unity in Bristol.
Or, you know, and be part of that change. Because if we all do that and engage in politics on that level, then, you know, maybe we can make these things change quicker.
And get back into a revolution of making our own stuff. You know, I think that making our own beer, growing our own tobacco, if people spend an awful lot of money on things like that as well, where they could be growing and making their own. And so coming back into these simple ways of, okay, how do we spend less? And a lot of that, I mean, you would know, it comes down to making your own stuff so that you're not sending money out.
Can you grow tobacco?
Absolutely, yeah, totally.
Let's try.
And so also this, you know, the mental health issue, so much of that is because there isn't community, there isn't support, there aren't networks of people coming together to look after their own community. And so we've also said to Big Brother, you know, okay, give us the handouts, you know, look after us, and rather than we the people looking after each other. So, you know, for me, there's also that part that we got to start looking after each other. Our community needs to start looking after the people, you know, that need help. There's times when people just need to be heard. They just want to sit down and talk. And we don't have the infrastructure, really, to have small, free community services where people can come. And it not being in the system, that we take control of the system ourselves and start putting that into place.
So we pay taxation, we pay tax. I mean, we pay tax and national insurance, which is 30% of our income, goes into what should be providing public services. And that money isn't used for that. You know, so I've worked in those sectors for years, and I've seen a decimation of community centres, you know, of reducing health services. And, you know, we need to be aware of what's actually happening
plus
with the economy.
You know, pay 30% plus VAT.
Yeah, we're paying a huge amount of money towards what? Defence?
Fat cat salaries in the public sector.
No, I disagree with that.
Loads of managers in the public sector.
That's just an excuse.
BBC,
to
NHS,
drive down spending
local
in
councils.
The public sector.
They're
most
all cutting
public
sector services, but keeping their own jobs at 100,000 a year.
Most public sector workers are paid about £20,000 a year.
Most of them are, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I just don't get into that because that's the message they want to pay, so they can drive down.
Can we get back to off-grid, please?
That's got everyone to leave. That's on the subject.
A guy in the middle of the front row who's been waiting to ask a question very patiently.
No, it was kind of a response to that, and we've all got a choice. Holly Higgins talks about a writer called Simon Sinek. And it's a really important point, because if we're arguing with people that are saying that these things are never going to happen, but we're kind of arguing for them, and we're kind of saying, yeah, but they're like, they need their support and all of this, but they're just going and buying their gadgets and spending all of their 20,000 little money on crap that we're sort of saying that they shouldn't be buying, that we're getting into this argument and it's pointless. But basically what we're doing is by sharing amongst each other, we're the instigators, we're the innovators, and we're building a bridge for the early majority, which is this bell curve, and the early majority are the ones looking over the shoulder going, oh, that looks interesting, or but it's probably not going to happen. And then And then, you know, Pedro's there doing his thing and his mum and dad are showing it. And all these people are going, oh, that's different. And suddenly they're all there and they're just ready. And then more people are doing it and we're all doing it. And then there's more people coming through and this bridge is getting bigger and the early majority come. And all of this late majority that we're all arguing, like, what about them? Like, how can they do it? It's just gonna happen. This tidal wave just bang. It's gonna hit them around the head, and here we go. And you're talking about on the political side, what we can do. Great point about getting involved. But there's a organization just set up now called Reset. And they're looking at the constitutional side of things. And I don't know if anybody's heard of Reset. It's quite a new thing. But basically, constitutionally, if we do it the way that it already exists, it's about in the wards and the parishes. Okay, it's just a local thing, but we could be an example for the rest of the world, where if only 10 members of that ward or that parish come together in a meeting, we can then come up with an idea and we can say possibly a referendum idea, and then we go to regional. So exactly the way that the system already works, and then we can take that to the government, to the parliament, to the queen, to the king, and say, right, we the people have got this now, this is our new thing. And 45 times since the Magna Carta, the people have taken it to the government, and 45 times out of 45, the government have accepted it. So it is about us coming together in these communities, in our wards and parishes, locally, and saying, we want change. And it, you know, it's a discussion. It's going to take a long time.
So are you referring to the new localism law that has come in that allows 7 people to get together in any ward to make a change to traffic or closed streets? Are you talking about that?
Yeah, and also this is in our constitution, in the Magna Carta and Bill of Rights, and I mean, I don't know enough about it, but this is like the idea.
You could use the new localism law to introduce off-grid, for example, in your area.
Neighbourhood planning.
Exactly, yeah. So people get together in their local areas where there's a few of us living in the same ward or parish and make a change just in that area that would allow other people or themselves to start living off-grid on land that was bare land, you know. Living ecologically, or whatever it might be. So maybe, if anybody wants to talk to me afterwards about how to take this forward, you know, and build something, I'd love to talk to you afterwards about it. We can keep going for as long as anybody wants. Do you want to say another word?
I was just going to say, bearing in mind the power structure, which, you know, is the reality. You know, it does exist, and it does exist to serve the people who are in power. I don't think any of these avenues are really going to be overly effective at creating the change we want to create. And I think to be aware of that, but to remain positive, is to just, like we've talked about, is communication between people. And this event is kind of one of those ways that, you know, some of us here have been involved in the Building Man since Friday, and it's been a great example of, like, well, this has kind of happened legitimately. I mean, it's gone through like an events license, and there's buildings that are happening that haven't strictly gone through planning, and, you know, it's about finding loopholes. And actually, you know, why should we have to ask for permission? You know, why should we have to go to the parish and say, well, can we do this? Can we have this? You know, there's a degree of like civil disobedience, I think, that needs to, and when that is applied en masse, it gets to the point where the people in power go, well, how do we deal with this? You know, and, you know, I don't know. I mean, I think asking for permission to kind of shit in the woods is ludicrous. You know, it's like.
Are you suggesting we should just stay here?
Well, yeah.
For a year.
But it's that kind of thing, you know. It's about like bending the laws and finding ways that you can actually do this, because, like, I mean, personally, I've learned so much in the space of, like, you know, under a week, and met so many people and have expanded my network beyond the capacity I could have done in the city. And it's all kind of been done legally. I mean, I don't know, maybe it hasn't, but it's that finding the avenues that you can communicate with people, because I don't think the power structures will ever allow you to do any of the things we're talking about. They're never going to create a law that allows you to go and you know, is it the One Planet thing in Wales which has happened, and you know, that's kind of indicating that you can, but then there's this roundhouse which has just been
La Masse, you mean?
No, it's is it Charlie and Emma or Charlie?
Yeah,
Charlie's Roundhouse, and they've gone through retrospective planning permission, which last week was denied.
Yeah.
And you know, all this crap about, you know, it's a blot on the landscape, and it's the most beautiful structure, like, you know,
it's
not in keeping with the landscape, and it's just absolute nonsense. And that's just an example that. And the reason the planning permission was denied was because they didn't want to set a precedent. And that precedent is this, we don't want people to be able to build their own houses. Like, you know, we're building a structure over there. It's cost us absolutely nothing. We're reclaiming materials. You know, so they're never going to allow you to live this way. You just have to
I think
do
it. It is about just going ahead and doing it. Caema Bon, check it out online if you haven't. CAEMABON. Caema Bon, it's an ecological retreat centre in Wales. And to start with, Eric, you know, there was no permission, no, that's not going to happen, no, you're not going to do it. So he just started to build anyway. And he's used the opportunity to build different structures. There's an adobe, there's a round wood, there's a stone. I mean, he's got all different kinds of ecological builds on there. And to start with, the council, when they found out, they came over and there's all these dwellings that have been built and they're there. And they look so great. That to start with there was a bit of like, oh no, you can't have it, but in the end the council came round because it is great, it is a great living example, they are safely well built, and they ended up getting permission, even though to start with it was just like no, he just went ahead and he just did it. And I think that is a part of any revolution. It's like you have to just go ahead and do it. It's illegal to go and plant food around the place that's not yours. You know, we need to just be challenging that and just doing it. I have a good friend in Worthing, in Sussex, who she does a lot of guerrilla gardening. And to start with, in all the newspapers, there was this, who is the guerrilla gardener? They must see the council offices. And it became this big thing that she was just turning wasteland into food-growing spaces, really beautiful little food-growing spaces, and she'd put a little sign there saying, please water me, please pick me. And in the end, communities started to happen around those gardens that she had planted. And people, the neighbours, would come out and start to water it. And then neighbours would start speaking to each other around this little plot and start sharing the food. And it's been amazing to watch these little seeds, these little hubs that she has created in a town, and which is totally illegal. It's totally illegal for her to grow this food. But she has, and now others are copying, and more people are replicating. And that is, I think, what we really have to do, is sometimes, you know, be outside of the system and just do what we know is right as well.
Until it becomes inside the system. Some friends of mine just did that in London, and Boris, the mayor, turned up last week and said it was all thanks to him.
I think with the planning permission thing, it does seem to be nearly impossible to get granted planning permission, but then when people persevere and people keep going, and it's in some ways it's the huge battle that puts people off, people do get through on appeal, and Tinker's Bubble got through on its first appeal, and then the government tried to haul it in, the Tory government overturned it and the High Court stopped it, and then the Tories got kicked out and Labour let it happen. And since then, Land Matters and Stewards Wood have had permission. More recently, La Masse managed to get it in advance, which was sort of groundbreaking. They were one of the first people to do it without sort of moving onto the land first. I mean, I'd say move onto the land, just go ahead, do it. And you know, then you can be showing what you're doing and showing that you're doing something decently. You're not just going to be lunching the land out and having a big tat site, because there is some legitimate fears out there that you're just going to show up in a truck and have loads of old engines sitting around the place. And yeah, even more recently, ELC got the Ecological Land Co-op got permission last year. My friend just got permission at Plotgate, where you're doing your documentary. He's got permission for his greenhouse and effectively got permission for his dwelling there once he's finished building his greenhouse. So I've not actually heard of many people losing in the appeals. Most of the people I've spoken to who've been talking to me about their appeals have come out and won at the end of it. So the system does seem to be geared a bit against us, but if you fight it and if you play the system by its rules, you can win in some ways.
It's also worth remembering that we are governed by consent. People give consent, and I think that is free. They can't do anything. They're not allowed to. That's a vocal, tricky thing that actually you can say, no, we don't want to say that you're wrong. So that's a strict point, but I think we are governed by consent.
That's probably a positive message
to the Boris Johnson quote, the Boris Johnson thing. He might have took credit for the community garden thing, but he did buy 3 water cannons recently.
Is that for playing with his kids? Okay, well, I think on that positive note, we'll end it there. Thank you.